I try to load these videos up with as much value as possible in order to honor your time spent here. A lot of what I say is going to have greater applicability sometime in the future. As events continue to unfold in this world, you're going to say, aha, this is really useful now. So, of course, if you don't plan ahead, how are you going to deal with the situations that arise? You have to get something in your hand now that is useful later. So we try to pack these videos with as much as possible. And so just bear with it. Bear with it. And I'll try to introduce all sorts of stuff that is going to be very, very useful, highly useful. The day-to-day just packed with stuff for me, so packed that try to explain it all. Well, it's possible. Amazing, amazing day. Again, the momentum is just tremendous. It's like getting ready to take off, as it were. Getting crucial insights that just completely resonate. And I just feel the whole resonation is just felt. It's felt, my whole being is feeling this resonation of, yes, this is it, this is it, this is it. You're right on it. You're absolutely right on it. And very true, very true. And it gets better and better and better. Each day the insights get deeper and deeper and deeper and resonating more and more strongly. So it's trending in the right direction. What is it on the verge of? I'm not, you know, entirely sure. I don't want to speculate too much. But the trend is tremendous, tremendous trend. So many, many key issues to introduce. One of them is diplomatic immunity. If you're wondering, how do you possibly deal with what is to come in the world? Claim diplomatic immunity, which I did today. I accepted diplomatic immunity. What kind of diplomatic immunity? Diplomatic immunity as part of the a mission from another dimension, another world here in this world. Just like they're diplomats here, like in the United States, from all the countries in the world, they have diplomatic missions in the United States, and they're under what's called diplomatic immunity, diplomatic law. There's different laws for diplomats in a foreign country because they're not citizens of the country. They're not protected by the country's laws, but they are protected by diplomatic law. So you here in this world, those who are tuned towards recognizing that there's absolutely no necessity to try and make death real and choose the death-free dimension, death-free realm, who are making the exchange of hypotheticals, those of you who are tuned to this, you have a mission here in this world, and you have every right to claim diplomatic immunity for that mission, which means the world, the laws of the world cannot touch you. You cannot be assassinated. You cannot be imprisoned. You cannot be harmed. You cannot be treated unfairly and all this kind of stuff. You can claim diplomatic immunity and then be under that protection. You say, well, where does the protection come from? It comes from the Holy Spirit. That's where it comes from. And it doesn't matter whether the world recognizes this or not. It's still there. Okay, an ostrich can stick its head in the sand. That doesn't mean the dangerous whatever is gone, whatever it's trying to hide from. So, diplomatic immunity. And now, if somebody claims diplomatic immunity here, there also can be attachés that are attached to the diplomatic mission. It may not be, there may be some diplomats, central diplomats, and then there's attachés who work with the mission, and they also have a certain degree of immunity as well. So you're thinking, well, maybe you're not able to get the vision of Christ, accept the vision of Christ right now, the vision of the overlay, the vision of timelessness. It's all talking about the same thing. Well, you can attach yourself to the diplomatic mission of those who do have that. You say, you can do that too. So you should think along those lines, because the laws are changing so rapidly, you're going to be shocked by what's coming. And if you don't have that type of immunity, and you are going in this direction that I'm pointing out, is the right direction, is the useful direction to go in, you know, you could be in trouble. That is true. And it's likely you'd be in trouble, because they're collecting databases on everyone. There's no point in trying to run and hide from that, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There's no point to that at all. The point is simply go as fast as possible towards freedom. And you can, along the way, you can be either attaché to a diplomatic mission or claim diplomatic immunity, which I've already accepted. I've accepted it today. I said, yeah, I accepted full diplomatic immunity today. The real gurus in the world are actually great friends to their disciples. They come to serve the disciples. Because for the gurus of the world, the only thing that has value in this world is their disciples. They're super important to the gurus because that passes on the freshness of the presentation. Again, you cannot really establish any legacy in a domain that fades, which impermanent. But you can have a fresh presentation of truth continuously going on. That is very possible. So the gurus are very keen on finding their disciples, more so than disciples are finding the gurus. It's the guru that finds the disciples. So I've been waiting, working, and we'll see what happens. But if I was a guru, I would be very keen on finding me, absolutely. Because the ripeness is there. I wonder if like fruit are hanging from a tree and they're getting ready to fall. I wonder if the fruit know they're about to fall. Maybe. There's probably a different feeling in the fruit, right? And so it's like that. I feel like my fruit is ready to fall. Definitely. I'm experiencing the various indications that song, signs, signs everywhere are signs. That's what's happening. So if I was a guru, I would be absolutely keen to find a disciple like myself who has worked nonstop their entire life, every day of their life, and especially the last 35 years in all-out sprint mode, in the last 17 years in double sprint mode, or sixteen, seventeen years in just complete double sprint mode, without ever missing a day. That's the kind of disciple you would look for. That's the one. That's what. So, and so, today I was thinking, like, if and when the guru introduces themselves, well, you know, I would bow to them. You know what would happen? Actually, the real guru bows to the disciple. Tell you the truth, because they're so happy that they have a disciple. They found someone in this world that is willing to carry on the work. And for them, that is worthy to them of bowing to, because out of gratitude, absolute gratitude, and they're so happy. They're so happy to come across their disciples, really. Way happier than the disciple is to come across them, way more. And they're there to serve. They're saying, let me do whatever you want. Let me do it, because it's all important to them. They want the tradition to continue of witnessing to the vision of Christ here in this world. That is just all important to them. So really, it's like they're the ones looking for us, as it were. And we don't know who the real gurus are, but they may not even be known in this world, actually. But when they come across someone who is ripe, then from their standpoint, that's something they bow down to out of gratitude and say, thank you for doing the work. They're so happy. And then they serve. They're here to serve. They're here to do whatever they can for you, because they are realize that the torch is continuously passed here. The torch is continuously passed. And that's what makes their work meaningful, is that the momentum continues. The momentum continues. So in my standpoint, my reaction would be simply, well, say, okay, I'll accept you as a probationary guru. Because I place a high value on everything I've done, the high work that I've done. Like if I went to like a corporation or something, I think the whole interview process is crazy. The corporation should be coming to us and interviewing us. Say, please come work for us. Please come work for us. Well, the headhunters do that, actually. The corporations have headhunters that do that. And it's not, for me, like I won't go to an interview. It's not that that I'm supposed to be begging, interviewing for a job. No, the corporation has to be, I'm the one doing the interviewing them. Should I give my very valuable services and time, precious time, to help their agenda? Should I be doing that? So I should be doing the interview. You should be doing the interview. You should be interviewing the corporations, whoever you're going to work for, not the other way around. So it's backwards right now. So if some guru comes to me, I'm interviewing them. So why should I be your disciple? Why should I? I know the value of the work I've done. So I'll accept you probationary in a probationary way. So, but that's about it. That's about it. Because they have to prove that they're worthy of disciples saying, yeah, okay, I will go along. I will carry the torch that you've been carrying. They have to prove that. It's up to them to prove it. It's up to them. And of course, any real guru would understand that and accept it. Say, yeah, I don't want you to accept me. Just, I want probation. That's what I want. And they'd recognize that is a real disciple right there. Saying, okay, I'll put you on probationary status. So that's it. You got to prove yourself. You got to show you're the real deal. So you need to look at these things in a different way, entirely different way. The gurus that come expect you to bow down to them and serve them and all that kind of stuff. No, that's not, those aren't the real gurus. No way. And if you've really been on the path, if you've really done the work, you're gonna know your value. You're gonna know your value. So I'm not going to just hand that value over to anybody. No way. Mm-mm. I know I have a lot of value right now because I'm seeing the whole picture. I'm seeing everything. I'm seeing exactly how it all works. And it's titanic. It's huge. It's huge. That came from all the work I've done, all the dedication. So I hope, hopefully someday a guru will come and help me out, because I definitely need some help. And keep the push going here. Keep the push going. In the meantime, keep working constantly at it. Keep working to get that vision of timelessness. And that's what I did today. And I went, you know, further and further and further towards that. And question you should have is, since continuity is the only issue, the question should be, how's your continuity? How do you feel as far as continuity-wise? That really should be the only question we ever ask each other. How are you feeling continuity-wise? And I'd say fine, absolutely fine. No trouble. Even though the progress is monumental, colossal, so fast and so immense and so profound, still I feel fine. I don't feel any trouble at all. So that means I've done the work so that to deal with the continuity problem, to move into the real solution to the continuity problem is what I'm really doing. Going towards that, which is what we're all trying to do. There's only one issue we have, that's the continuity issue. There's no other issue. And there's only one issue in relation to that, which is what is useful and what is useless. You discard the useless, you take up the useful. That's it. The whole thing can be simplified down to that. And you should practice that, simplifying that. Super important. Because when the way the world's going right now, you're going to have to be able to stand on simplicity. Not on complexity, simplicity. Otherwise, forget it. I had a dream last night. I was driving down these train tracks and trying to get somewhere. And I said, oh, the only route I have is on these train tracks. And then I decided to turn around because my cat jumped out of the car. I said, oh, I gotta go back and get that cat. So I went back to get the cat, and the cat was over somewhere off the tracks. And I went over and parked and picked the cat up. And suddenly this train came screaming down the tracks, and I had no idea. The tracks look abandoned. I had no idea trains still traveled on there. And my God, if I hadn't have gone back to get that cat, I would have been smashed to smithereens by that train. The train was just like a bullet train. My gosh. And then the cat slipped out again, and I had to go. So I was chasing the cat all night in these dreams. And probably the cat is actually like the guru. It's helping me. It's leading me away from severe troubles, saving my life. Of course, a cat has 9 lives, right? Yeah, you might say this cat is saving me 9 times over. That train, what does it represent? Well, in the past, I used to think that train represented like an asteroid or a planet X or something comes screaming through our solar system or something. But I think it means training. It means training. It means being put in your role, trained for your role, and set in your role so that progress can be really fast And what are everyone progressing towards? Completion. Completion. What is completion? It's nonsense. Okay. How? Why does wholeness need completion? What can complete wholeness is the question, right? Something that can complete wholeness? Wholeness doesn't need to be completed. Reality is one indivisible whole. We never left reality. We don't need to complete anything. Nothing. And the more we try to complete stuff, the deeper into darkness and forgetfulness and obscuration we go about reality. Because there's nothing that needs to be completed in reality. Absolutely nothing. Every reality was created whole. It's always whole, will always be whole. One indivisible whole. It expands, but the wholeness, like you blow up a balloon, the wholeness of the balloon is still there, and you keep expanding, but it's still all there. It's not incomplete at all. The reality is totally complete, beyond any concept of completion. There's no need for any completion whatsoever. So this world is frantically working on trying to complete stuff. What? The contingency plan. The contingency plan. To have a contingency plan in case reality gets destroyed. That's what we're frantically working on. And the more we do this, the more we forget reality. Therefore, it's useless. Because the only use a hypothetical has is to remind us of reality. That's the only issue we have, because that solves the continuity problem. We need some hypothetical that reminds us of reality. So we cannot have a hypothetical that has anything to do with completion. The opposite. Complete disinterest in any completion whatsoever. Now, is it possible to have that? And the answer is yes. That is what I've been working on, guiding everyone towards, encouraging and reassuring everyone towards. That's called the vision of Christ, the vision over the overlay, the blessed vision, the vision of a blessed existence, vision of oneness, the empty mind, vision of no thing, various other terminologies. There's a lot of terminologies all talking about the same thing, and I'm getting closer to that for sure. I don't know how close I am, but I'm certainly getting a lot closer to that. And what it is you simply see everything as it is right now, completely freed of any process at all. So the issue of completion, if there's no process, the issue of completion gone. You don't need anything to be completed. You don't need to have any awareness of process or completion whatsoever. You simply see everything just as it is right now, free of any time whatsoever or any process. In that very instant, the very moment, in that moment, you see the very moment, every moment. This is the eternal vision, the vision of eternity, the vision of nowness, the great space, the great void, as it were. All these things are referring to the same vision. And it's very doable for all of us. Very doable. I'm doing it right now. I'm closing in on it right now. And have been working on that for a long time. And you drop any awareness of process or completion or trying to complete anything. It's not needed because it's useless. It doesn't remind us of reality. The only issue we have is continuity, and the only way to solve that continuity problem is to be reminded of reality, and the only way we can do that is to drop process, drop time, drop the issue of completion, drop all that, and see something that's changeless. And the now moment is changeless, because every moment you're simply seeing that moment exactly as it is, free and clear of every other moment, no linkage with process whatsoever. And apparently I hear that it's very sublime, this vision. I have not yet experienced it. I'm moving towards it. I feel I'm moving towards that, and starting to get little glimmers of it. It's starting to sparkle a little bit. Metaphorically speaking, I'm not seeing any light, play of light or anything like that, but feeling wise, I feel it's starting to scintillate for me and attract me more and more profoundly. It's an unobstructed vision. Imagine if you could have a view where it was completely unobstructed and would always remain unobstructed. Imagine what would you pay for such a view, right? People in this world fight like crazy to try to get some view, like at Pebble Beach or something. Imagine if you had a view that was 360 degrees, completely unobstructed, and would never be obstructed by anything. Even the whole universe could be destroyed. It wouldn't obstruct your view. Your view can never be obstructed. How would that be? An unobstructed view. Wow. That's what it is. Because you are seeing everything simply exactly as it is right now. So whatever happens in this world, you just see each moment exactly as it is. But and there's this complete stillness, this complete peace, stillness. That's what you're experiencing, and nothing can obstruct it. Because whatever happens, you're not seeing process at all. You're seeing just whatever is this moment, that is what is, without any seeing anything trying to change in any way. So that vision is always unobstructed. Nothing can obstruct it. And I saw that today. Nothing can obstruct it. How valuable is that to you? My gosh, how valuable. How valuable. I mean, in this world, everything gets obstructed at some point, right? You buy a house, you got a beautiful view of the mountains, the neighbor sells their house, someone else moves in, they plant a whole bunch of trees, the trees grow up to be 60 feet high, completely blocking your view, and there you go. Stuff happens all the time in this world, where whatever we get here, it changes, it's obstructed. But what if you had a view, a vision that doesn't change at all, never can change, never can be obstructed, is always completely pure, purely there, pure seeing. With no way can you ever lose the sight of that. Your vision doesn't depend on your vision, body's eyes going bad at all. Nothing can obscure it, nothing can take it away from you, nothing can trademark it, nothing can do anything to it. Can't be touched, because you're viewing just each moment free of any and all process, everything immediately as it is, and as the Neophytians say, full stop. So I may have been a little rough on the Neophytians, if I will see, but they do seem to be talking about this, so we'll see. A lot of the language, a lot of the stuff they're talking about seems to be, you know, along these lines in some ways. But as far as what I see, I see it very clearly what's going on. I see the context very, very clearly. So, and I don't feel necessity to put it into Neo-Advaitin terms at all. I really don't. But I can see how they could put it into those terms, absolutely, yeah. And you can see how maybe Eckhart Tolle, various teachers, can use their own terminology, their own presentation. But there again, each one has to have their own fresh presentation. And it seems like there's been kind of a lockstep in Neo-Advaitin teachings that you're supposed to follow along with what Ramana Maharshi, you know, that supposedly what they suggested, and there's a way of talking about it. Just like it's sort of become very cliquish. So I've never been part of that. Because it has to be fresh. It has to be fresh. You just can't say, you know, who's asking, you know, or where's the I or thing. I mean, that becomes stale. It becomes dogmatic at some point. And I see some dogmatism creeping in some of those things, some of those teaching lineages, etc. But I also see some good stuff as well. Some freshness, some good, you know. So it's a mixed bag. Dogmatism will creep in everywhere in this world, actually. And there's nothing wrong with saying, hey, I feel it's a little dogmatic. That's okay. That's all perfectly okay for me to say that. But I'm not certainly condemning any of the teachers or anything like that. Just saying maybe it's a little stale. Maybe it's a little stale. And for me, that's why I'm not part of that Neo-Advaitin movement, at least at this point, because I bring a very fresh perspective to the entire situation. More along the lines of A Course in Miracles. But then again, that's also become very cliquish. Very cliquish. Like I say, a lot of stuff is like the spiritual fashion shows, and you're supposed to learn the lingo and speak the lingo, and then you're in. You're supposedly, you got the inside track because you do that. Now, there's nothing wrong with a teacher using their own language and other people following along with that, because it's helpful. It's helpful. It's when you sort of get this, a lot of satellites who are really not with it, using the same lingo, kind of like to say, hey, I'm with it too. It's kind of copying, you know, like it's a fashion, spiritual fashion show. Now, that's not helpful. But again, that's no reason to reject anything either. It's just that you notice it. I mean, I just notice the dynamics that are going on. I mean, just say, okay, I see that dynamic. I see dynamics with Muji, what's going on with the satsang. I notice those things. Sometimes I comment. But again, I'm just noticing it. He's doing his thing, and he seems to know what it's about. He's one that seems to know what it's about, and he has his way of presenting it, etc. And then I just noticed there are various aspects of it that just catch my attention. Say, you know, just so. But everyone has to be fresh. Everyone has to be fresh. Each one carries the freshness, that seed of freshness. It's like planting a seed that's going to grow into a beautiful tree, but it's a very fresh tree, very unique tree, very wonderful tree. Give shade to many. Give shade to many. And my lineage, I don't even know what it is, but it doesn't matter because I'm right on it. Whatever it is, I've gotten help for so many people, really. I can really say I've really been helped by all the spiritual teachers in the world, past and present, a little bit somewhere, right? A little bit from everyone must have filtered down. You know, the ones I mentioned are just obvious ones, but really, so many obscure ones too that you've never heard of that have helped me actually, either directly or indirectly. Indirectly, we're helped in so many, 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 many ways. Even though we haven't ever met the teacher, they have somehow transmitted some of this awareness of, yes, this vision is there for us. Yes, I attained it, and you can too. And that percolates. So I have gratitude to every teacher who's ever been on this planet or anywhere, because definitely they've helped me out. And there's some, of course, more obviously than others. And so you can feel that same way too. And there's nothing wrong with being aware of dogma, of staleness, and all that stuff. And you realize, hey, it's just like, look at all the stuff that's done in Jesus' name. And does that mean I reject Jesus? Of course not. He's done more than anyone to help me, actually. Really. He's done the most. And Nanamayama is the second most, as it were. Or maybe they're co-1A, 1B, so to speak. I don't know. They've both done a tremendous amount to help me. But there are many, 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 many others, too. Every witness to the vision of Christ is an enormous help to everyone. To everyone. Everyone. Everyone that eventually will get on the quote-unquote path, which is not really a path at all. How do you finish the path? You finish the path by realizing you don't need to finish the path. That's how you finish it. So it's a verbal paradox and always will be. And the ego gets all upset about this. Says, wait a minute, did you finish it or not finish? And it drives the ego nuts. The ego thinks that it needs verbal answers, conceptual answers. Not true. Not true. To speak of it conceptually, you have all these paradoxical statements, conceptual constructs. The way to finish the path is to realize you don't need to finish it. In fact, the way to finish the path is to realize you don't need to finish anything. You don't need to see any completion anywhere. Because wholeness doesn't need any completion. It's been complete from the very beginning. It's been whole from the very beginning. So you let go of the sight of completion, the efforts toward completion, as it were. You let go of all that. You're not even seeing that anymore at all. You're seeing just the eternal now is what you're seeing. You're seeing this blessed overlay. That's what you're seeing. And everything is seen in that. All the staging is seen in that context. So you don't finish any path. The gurus are the ones that realize they don't need to finish the path. They've realized it, and they've accepted it. They've accepted it. So when you accept that you don't need to finish any path, you don't need to finish anything, you don't need to keep trying to finish anything, you don't need to see anything being finished at all. You don't need absolutely the opposite. You need to see everything absolutely as it is. Now, when you see that, what are you seeing? Are you seeing things? No, you're not. That's why Nanamayama would say she only saw God everywhere. That's all she said. I don't see any things at all. I only see God, period. Only God. That's what you're seeing. But that's saying you only see this eternal now everywhere. Do you see a plant? Do you see this? No, you're not seeing a plant. You're not really seeing a plant at all. Is it really a plant? No. No, 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 no. It's an effort towards completion. In our normal perception, you're seeing the plant. It has a life cycle. It goes towards completion. But when you see it right this minute, it's not a plant. It is one total moment of simply beauty and presence. It's simply presence. You're just seeing presence. You're not seeing things, as it were. Presence. This beautiful, one complete, whole, beautiful presence everywhere, unobstructed. It's like you're seeing God and you're seeing all these different aspects of God, but that's what you're seeing. You're not seeing any process taking place whatsoever. There's no process. That is what we're headed towards. If you want to know what Anandamayi Ma, why she was so completely blissful, that's why. That's what she was seeing. And she said, you can all see this too. So that's my role model. Jesus is like my teacher, and Anamaya is my role model. That's how I put it. Sort of different aspects. So Jesus is my number one teacher, and Anamaya is my number one role model. That's how I see it. And we can get there. A lot of people try to get there through drugs. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. Absolutely doesn't work. That's not the way. Those people who tried to make it on drugs, where are they now? Where are they now is the question, right? Have they spent 35 years never missing a single day of full-on complete effort every day? No, of course not. They go on their trips, they go on their highs, and then they crash, and then they, you know, do other things, and then they again, and then they, you know, get onto other stuff, and then they burn out, and where are they? Where are they? Show me someone who has succeeded on the, with this through drugs. Show me anyone, even one. Nobody. I should tell you something. You do it through honesty, you do it through patience, you do it through trust. And perseverance and determination. And those various attributes, forgiveness, kindness, all those things, you do it through that. And you close in. You know there's a goal, but it's paradoxical, and it is tough to see initially. Really, this is just all unfolding. Kind of, it's interesting because I've always been right on track, but I didn't. It was still kind of fuzzy. But the real stark clarity when that comes, you start to see. Oh wow, this is what it is. Now I see it. Okay, now I'm seeing it. That's great. That is great. Paradoxically, you succeed when you accept that you don't need to succeed. When you accept nobody needs to succeed. There's absolutely no need for success at all. None. That's when you, quote unquote, succeed. That's when you deal with the continuity problem, which is ultimately success. So when you can see that there's never been any need for any success whatsoever. In fact, there never has been any success. So you're really just being very practical. Very practical, actually. It's the ones that are hell-bent on success, the ones that are on that train, that have the dream, that are, what are they doing? They're locked into their roles, going as fast as possible to try to get somewhere. Where are they getting? Absolutely nowhere. They're just going around in circles. Because they're trying to complete something. They're trying to succeed. And they're completely deluded. Unfortunately, they're engaged with a severe delusion. You don't need to see any success, not in the past, not in the future, not now, ever, none. You can see everything as just one, just oneness, vision of oneness. Anandamayi said, you cannot succeed except you must have the vision of oneness. That is absolutely necessary. Because why? That deals with the continuity problem. The only success there is successful dealing with the continuity problem. Have to. And the vision of oneness is what does that. Jesus says the same thing. So that's our goal. Absolutely is the goal. There's no reason to be secret or whatever about it. No, that's the goal. That is the goal. And we need to close in on it. And you really need to keep going on it. And it just, but again, it is so seemingly paradoxical, counterintuitive, isn't it? The stuff today is just like blowing my mind, which is just great. I say, fine, keep going. This is great. No problem. I love it. We brought up on the notion we're supposed to get on the spiritual path and we need to take this path. And I always resisted that. I said, no, that's not it. And I got in a lot of arguments with spiritual people when I was young, and they really rejected me severely and thought I was just a arrogant idiot or something. I don't know. They didn't like me because I said, that's not it. It's not it. And finally I got on the path, you know, and it's been hell ever since. No, there is no path. It's useless, completely useless. You don't need to succeed at any path at all. It's giving up any notion of success whatsoever, because that is useless to remembering reality, completely useless. and there's some meta use, you know, meta success would be dropping hypotheticals altogether. That's understood, but don't make level confusion. You don't bring level confusion. The ego loves level confusion because it tries to say, well, let's just call it a stalemate, and, you know, no, it's no stalemate. There's no stalemate at all. Only a, just pure conceptuality can you try to bring a stalemate into the situation, which is just completely eccentric. So it's not a stalemate at all. Just utter whimsy to look at it that way. Success comes from solving the continuity problem, which comes from recognizing you don't need to see success anywhere. There's no necessity to see anything taking place at all in this world. The still presence, you can experience the still presence continuously here. And everything will be exactly the same when you came into the world as when you left. That still presence will be exactly the same. You'll see the world is, even though the world constantly changes, it's all within this context of nothing taking place at all. You're not seeing anything taking place. You're just seeing the continual presence, beautiful presence, in a sort of a kaleidoscopic way that just every moment is so beautiful and unobstructed. So I'm seeing that this is all true. What Jesus talked about, what Ananda Mahima showcased here, is all true. It's absolutely true. They gave us the right advice. They give us the right advice. And I mean Jesus in A Course in Miracles, not the dogma that has been posited from those who believe that they need to succeed at something and that Jesus' motivation to succeed at something. No, he's motivation to give up any effort to succeed at anything, including dying, including failure. And no need to complete anything at all. So there's no need for any time at all. You don't need to see time. Don't need to see any time at all. You can see timelessness. The vision of timelessness. We are capable of doing that. The teachers tell us we're absolutely capable of it. So I'm working on that, trying to get that. And today it came, I feel like I got closer and closer and closer. Really, I was really feeling it, actually. Let me see if I can throw in a tape. I'm going to try to give you a little production value. I don't know if people really feel like they need that at all either, but it may not hurt. Let me throw something in here. It may be a little juk because this has a hard time streaming high definition stuff, and the video is high definition. But you might get, I don't know if it's going to work or not. Let me see here. Let me give it a try.
All day today, profound insights all day, non-stop, even getting into a groove of feeling so close to quiet mind just during the daytime. So very significant what's going on right now as things unfold. Very, very significant.
Hey, it worked. Okay, I'm going to show you another one, which is from the day before. Let's can this one work? Let's try this. This one we just saw was today, showing you that just during the day, driving, doing whatever you're doing, these insights can be unfolding. You can be feeling it. I was literally feeling so close to quiet mind that just driving the truck, I was able to just say, wow, it's just a whole panoramic clarity is just opening up for me. Panoramic just keeps getting wider and wider and wider. And okay, this one is from the day before, which would have been Monday, Tuesday, the 29th. Let's give this a try.
So where do you have insights, great insights? Wherever you are. I just had one right here, so. It's that. That's what it's all about. Wherever you are, don't wait. So where do you have insights? Great.
There you go. Just saying, hey, wherever you are, you can realize that you don't need to see anything, any effort towards completion. Continuity, you recognize continuity is the only problem. I don't need completion, has no role to play in solving the continuity problem whatsoever. And you can get and say, suddenly say, oh my gosh, that opens up quiet mind, the peace beyond understanding. It opens it up. You suddenly realize that you're opening up to it. anywhere you are. You don't have to be in a cave. You don't have to be a caveman, a cavernica, a caveman. You don't have to be one of those. That's okay too. You can do it there too. Fine. You can open up there too. But you can literally be going about your day, and when you, and you can feel it. You can feel it, and you can pray. You can spend your day praying, silently praying. As you go to work, you're praying, and you say, come on, like I'm just saying, like, come on, full blast, let's go, full blast, let's do it now. It's like that, right now. I don't need any time to see time at all, right now. No reason to wait. Waiting's eccentric. Why do I need to wait? Close, moments of closeness can be trillions of those. That's completely useless. That still is into trying to go towards completing something. Completing the wholeness, trying to complete the whole somehow, trying to get a fragment to complete the whole. No need to see any of that. No need to see any fragments at all. No need to see any of that right now. Just constantly push, like that. Intense. Then you get tired, maybe after a while, and then gratitude. When you get tired, just say grateful for the help. And work on gratitude, and then push some more, and then the insights, and it just snowballs. You snowball it. Just keep snowballing it. Build the momentum, snowball it. Just think about that. You don't need any to be to see anything that has to do with any kind of success at all. Everything just as it is. And of course, if you see it just as it is, what purpose does it have? What purpose does anything have when you see it just as it is? Then the purpose is simply presence, isn't it? All you feel, all you're seeing is presence. If you see everything exactly this moment, what is it doing? It's not doing anything. Just sheer presence. And that takes on a completely different feel than anything else, any other type of perception. But we're looking at stuff we think process. No, you exchange process for presence. That's the whole goal. You exchange process for presence. Exchange awareness, seeing process. Instead of process, you see presence. When you choose that, there's no process that can obscure presence. You're seeing simply presence, moment for moment, moment for moment. Whatever happens, all you're seeing is presence. It's seamless. It is seamless. So nothing that happens in the so-called domain of process has any effect on the vision of presence. It has no effect on it. Can't interfere, can't do anything to it. And you can sense this, right, in some way, whether dimly, obscurely. You say, yeah, I kind of see, understand what's going on. I feel that a little bit. That's really good. That is really good. That's what's needed. You just say, I don't quite get it, but I know it's there to get. And all that's happening with me now is I'm starting to get it, actually really get it. And agree with it and say, ah, yeah, I agree with that. Absolutely. Makes perfectly reasonable. It's just crystal clear. Of course. You say, of course. It's obvious. It's that kind of reaction. When you start having reactions that are wholehearted, you feel like sort of a wholehearted reaction, as it were. There's no blockage anywhere. Then you just like, wow, I'm ringing like a bell with this. Hit the bell and it's very pure ringing. You say, you feel I'm really ringing purely with this. Then you know, that's great. Really great. What happens to those, though, that don't do that? Who basically... I'll tell you what the world's involved in with right now. I had a really great conversation with some people today about that and brought out so clear. Oh, my gosh. It's all about trying to build a utopia here. It's all about trying to complete something here. And in order to do that, the ends justify the means, and the means is to actually assign everybody roles, the right roles. And the goal, the way that's being done, is there's going to be a centralized bureaucracy, one global bureaucracy, whose purpose is to assign roles to everybody on the planet. And it'll be a top-down sort of thing. Those who are supposedly wiser about how to build this perfect world, perfect planet, will have their administrators underneath them, who will have their administrators under them, who have this bureaucratic army under them, who will purpose will be to assign roles. Now, why do you think they're data harvesting more and more and more and more and demanding that you use your real name, et cetera, et cetera? Data harvesting, why? Because they want to have databases on everybody, and then they'll run algorithms on those, and then they'll assign roles to you. The whole purpose is to assign roles to everybody on the planet. That is the whole purpose to it all. That's the end game. And then through that, we're supposedly going to be able to build a perfect planet, and peace will prevail, and everybody's going to be happy. It is so naive to just be utterly, totally eccentric, completely whimsical, completely eccentric, utterly naive, which, you know, whimsy is. You have to, isn't aware of its whimsy. Because that has absolutely nothing, no useless in reminding us of reality. Totally useless. Totally useless. And engaging and trying to embrace what is totally useless is completely eccentric. So those who are trying to build this new world order, this global government and global bureaucracy and assigning roles to everybody, which is why they want to know what your name is again, to collect all the data to find out what role to assign you. Totally eccentric. Totally. That's the best that you can say. What they're doing is they're trying to embrace utter uselessness, which is totally eccentric. And they don't have a clue. They don't have even the slightest clue of how to deal with a continuity problem. And this is their version of trying to deal with it. And it's the opposite. Opposite. And unfortunately, why I have this sense of urgency for all of you is that in their vision of what to do with the world, what roles to assign, there is no role whatsoever for what we're doing. No role whatsoever. None. None. That's why, like on YouTube, the categories, choose a category for your video. There's no category, spiritual or religious or salvation. Salvation, okay, this video has to do with salvation. There's no categories there. They don't put categories like that there. They don't see that that is a useless role, and their way of looking is totally useless role. Totally useless. Totally. Totally. So imagine what they're going to do with that, which they view as totally useless. What they're going to do, they're going to assign you to pick up garbage. At the very best, they'll first try to re-educate you to accept a better role. But when they find you're hopeless, they'll put you on all sorts of meds and treatments, and then they'll have you picking up dead squirrels off the road or something, roadkill, or they'll exterminate you, which usually is what happens. They have ways of doing that these days, where they just you log on to your computer and they say your username and stuff. Just your username is not recognized, huh? Huh? What? I just had that happen to me. It's like weird. It's like, whoa, uh-oh. Simply, you are deleted from the database, and your username to access all your banking, do everything to function in society, gone. Your ability to function is wiped out just like that, just simply by tagging your username. You can't do anything. You can't buy, you can't sell, you can't do anything. That's why cashless society, they're trying to bring that about too. So they're frantically trying to get this underway, and they're you know, almost there actually, and they will get there. You would think so. They're very close to getting there actually right now, and I don't see anything really standing in their way. And everything's in place for that. So those who want to accept the vision of Christ have no role at all in such a world, none. And so they're as good as dead from the way they view you. You're just a useless eater, chewing up carbon credits, and not giving anything back to society whatsoever. And therefore, you probably best depart the scene. That's the view, the zero usefulness. So it's super important to keep going with this reassurance to the point where you simplify it and simplify it and simplify it and feel you can resonate with it more and more. Again, the resonation is something more than just conceptual framework and intellect. It's more than that. There's greater depth to it. You see it, and the seeing expands. It generalizes. Then you know that's when you're getting it. It's not a rigid structural framework like, oh, I see something academically, I can repeat that sentence. That's why I don't need to repeat the course, A Course in Miracles, or what they say, the sentence. That's fine. It can be helpful, but there's no need to memorize or do that. That's not it. Because what it is this domino effect, a chain reaction, where you feel like it's just rippling through your being and touching off insights everywhere. And it's whole, you're expanding, your mind is able to now be aware of so the domain of insight and the profundity of it all. And there's depth to it. That is the path, per se, as we say. That's what it really is. So when you're having that, when you're able to contemplate ideas and suddenly you feel, oh my gosh, this is useful here. I feel the usefulness of it all. And there's like sort of a expansion of the clarity everywhere. And so then you know you're really progressing and succeeding, really. Whereas if you're just like taking notes, okay, now what did he say? He said this and this and that. And then parroting it back and saying, okay, well, this is what you said. And I think I have written down, do I have written down accurately what you said? Oh, then I must get an A in the class, right? No, that's academics. This is not academics. It has nothing to do with academics. Never has and never will. This has to do with salvation. This has to do with solving the continuity problem. This has to do with the vision of presence, vision of timelessness, vision of Christ, peace beyond understanding. It has to do with that. And the getting the continuity into that. That's what it's all about. So again, whatever you hear, the purpose for hearing it is so it can begin to reverberate and touch off other insights, other related constellations of insights. It's affecting the whole constellation of your clarity. And you kind of feel that. You say, wow, I feel depth to that. I'm feeling this depth. And you don't even feel much need to explain it, or to categorize it, or label it, or even talk about it, or anything. You can feel the depth to it. That's the real path. That's what really has to be done. So if you're reading, don't worry about trying to remember what you read or repeat it on some test or anything. There's no test. Just let it trigger some depth in you. Let it keep triggering depth. That's all. That's all that's important. That you feel it's triggering the depth. Like you're looking, you're saying, oh, it's like peeking beneath the surface of the water with a mask, and you're looking beneath the surface, and suddenly you see, oh, I see depth now. I see depth, more and more depth. Wow. And you adjust to that depth. You say, wow, it's really, really wonderful depth. I'm seeing so much there, and I didn't even see before. It's like that. Triggers, constantly triggering of more and more depth. That's why people at satsang, they listen. There's a different kind of listening. They're not trying to memorize what's being said or what's happening or anything like that. They're simply letting all these triggers take place, and just being very quiet, very still, and just letting it happen, and just being aware of it. Yes, and grateful, and saying, "Yeah, great, grateful. This is great, very great, good." Not trying to then come up to the teacher and say, hey, okay, so I triggered this and this and this and this. And not trying to catalog anything. Not trying to catalog. The more you try to catalog, the more you slow it down. Because if anything, you see, whenever you see something clearly, it really affects all other clarity. It really has a gestalt-like effect on you. So it's really gestalt. It's like gestalt therapy. I remember it was Fritz Perls that started gestalt therapy. That was very big back in the day. And it really was one of the more enlightened approaches to therapy. That you are a whole, as it were, looking at it a whole, and you're not the sum of any parts or anything. And then everything that touches you is it touches all of you. It's a gestalt, the totality. And don't try to go at it linearly, you know. Don't try to plow some linear road like that train's very linear, very linear, very linear. the only problem with the Gestalt therapists, et cetera, is they didn't realize just how far you could actually go. What the real prize is. The real prize. They're trying to activate human potential or something like that. Well, human potential, what is that? It's spiritual potential. And spirit potential is to be aware of presence and only presence. That's the potential here in this world. That's the real potential. Vision of timelessness is the potential vision of Christ. That's what real potential is. Everything else is useless, really. It is useless. Only that is useful. The more you see that, the better off you'll be. Anything other than that is useless, really useless, unless you turn it to helping you get to what is useful. But then its usefulness is only a secondary type of usefulness. It's not useful in itself, whereas the presence, the perception of presence is useful in and of itself. It's like a car. You want to get somewhere, you drive the car. It's useful to get you there. But once you get there, you know, the car is not useful anymore. You want to see the beauty. You want to get out of the car and see the beauty. So, we have to make haste. Have to make haste right now. I saw something very disquieting today, and I inquired into it a little bit. I'll show it to you. And let me preface it a little bit. I don't like showing the stuff here that is you know, kind of a downer. But you have to take it in the context of, hey, we need to continue with the reassurance. It's super important. And because what is coming in this world is big trouble, is attempt to fit everybody into roles that are prescribed roles. There's also other stuff coming. There's, if you really want to get down to it, there's a terrible financial problem on its way. And they want to solve there's really an underlying meanness to the world of trying to solve this financial problem, which is basically get rid of all the people over 50 or whatever. You know, already if you're like 50 something, etc., and you're out of work, good luck finding any work. Enormous discrimination. Okay, so I'm in that demographic entirely, and I know exactly what's going on. They would really like all the people over 50 to die off, because then they wouldn't need to be taking any Social Security, would they? They wouldn't be needing any medical treatment, would they? Imagine if all the people over 50 were dead right this minute, how that would help the world finances. Imagine. No pensions, no retirement, none of that stuff. So the younger people, some of them, there's a trend within the younger generations to look at the older people and say, wow, wouldn't it be great if they weren't even here? Wouldn't that be great? So that is more than crossed their minds. I can assure you of that. And one of the ways they're attempting to hasten the process is just by stressing us out so bad by constant change, super fast, profound, severe change and rearranging everything. The stuff that only younger people can handle. You have to be very nimble to handle stuff like that. And when you're 20-something, you can handle it. So what they're doing is they're trying to make a situation in the world where even the 20-somethings are stressful, but they can barely handle it. But the 50-somethings, over 50, they can't handle it. They cannot adapt that fast. They can't handle it. And it's stressing. It's killing them. The stress is killing them. Really. The stress is almost killing me. Really. Those I know, they're almost dead from stress. Just from stress. Stress is a killer. Very, very, it's the number one killer in the world, as a matter of fact, stress. And the stuff that they're doing to change society and all this stuff is extremely stressful to older people. Unbelievably stressful. And they're crumbling. And the pace is going to pick up. And before you know it, older people will be dying like crazy, just dying everywhere. From suicide, from stress-related disorders, from trying to self-medicate with alcohol and pills, to getting various diseases and sicknesses, and boom, 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 be dropping like flies. Culling. This is one way to cull the population. This is incredible stress. War, break down your immune systems, all this stuff. So only the young can survive. Basically, the mantra is, let's have only the young survive, and then just think, we'll have solved all those problems. Financial problems, all this stuff, right? Solved. That's literally what's going on if you want to get down to the nitty gritty of it. Of course, not all, I'm not making some, you know, judgment on everybody at all. I'm just talking, just an observer, neutral observer, as it were, just of saying, okay, this is what I see. This is what's going on here in the world. Like I was just an observer, and reporting back, say, okay, this is what I see taking place here. Absolutely, that's taking place. You get a feeling like you can't make it. You just want to give up. That's the feeling I have as far as functioning in the world. Say, no way. The future? No, I can't do it. Everything is changing too fast. The laws, changing all the laws, all the rules, constant changing of laws and rules, and what's expected of you. And as you get older, you're not nearly as alert and nimble and adroit and can push yourself to like adjust super fast all this stuff. No, you just can't. You can't keep up. You cannot keep up. They're trying to run us all to death. Really, it's really what's the pace? They're making the pace so strong. It's like the Bataan death march. They're trying to just put you on this march, and just everybody basically drops out and dies along the way. That's, and they say, oh no, we were just marching you to the nice camps where you could rest in a nice camp, but we had to get there first, and oh, it's too bad everybody died along the way. It's like that. I say this world is really a Bataan death march, which you can look up, you can Google that if you need to. Very well known. That's what's really taking place in this world. And then there's a lot of other stuff that's going to come as well that is just going to shock the older people so bad. I mean, I've been shocked many times. I've been shocked, almost died from the severe. I don't think I can go another day because everything is becoming too expensive. And that's another thing. Just simply make it so expensive, the older people just can't handle it at all. And stress them out, etc. It's a horrible thing that's taking place in this world. Horrible, 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 horrible. And I'm amazed that the older people, our generation, is not more into satsang, inquiry, reassurance, etc. It's just amazing to me. It's just a wow. Wow, I would expect a much greater response, really, I do. A lot of the people that are responding here are younger people, actually, who are actually very, very kind of spiritually advanced types that get it. But from a practical standpoint, older people, 50-something people, wow, they should really be with it now, and they're not. I'm not finding that at all. Not at all. It's just like, whoa, come on. Pick up the pace, folks. I mean, there's a lot of them in the Neo-Vita camps, etc. Various stuff. Some of the baby boomers, those kind of types. But, I mean, they should wake up. They should wake up and realize what is coming for them. Because I'm right there in that demographic, and I know exactly what's coming. And it's going to put you in the grave, is what it's going to do. There's a lot of ways to put people in the grave that are coming. A lot of ways. And if one doesn't get you, another is going to get you. But the remedy is perception of presence. Perception of presence is the remedy. And I know you've heard this 1,000 times maybe. But it is very doable. It's very doable. But you need to begin to resonate with that, which is what I bring the global challenge, is resonating with that. I call it relocation. Yeah, that's part of it. Relocate the presence. But by perception of presence is the intermediate step to actually relocating to the death-free realms. It absolutely is a continuity, step in continuity to that. Big time, huge, necessary step. I mean, you just cannot go to the death-free realms without some sense of continuity to them. You cannot, because that happened to me. It happened to me. I was taken there in consciousness. My awareness was taken there. And I was looking around, and I've told the story several times. And I just started noticing, whoa, wait a minute. Wait, I started noticing some differences. I said, this seems like a beautiful, beautiful park. And I said, yeah, there's something a little different about this place. And then I began noticing, then I'm checking closer and closer. And then I suddenly was shocked. I said, my gosh, nothing's ever died here. Nothing's ever been harmed here. There's been no threat here. There's been no trouble, no accidents, no sickness, nothing. Everything is pristine. Wow. And always will be. I said, holy cow. And at that point, I said, ooh. And then I got shocked. It shocked me. And I lost my awareness of the place because I had a continuity problem with that. So if you use in this world, the perception of presence here in this world, then there's not going to be any continuity problem at all going to the death-free realms. No, easy, easy. And that's even better. That's even better. It's even a better reminder. But this intermediate step, this step in continuity, this big step in continuity can be taken right now. We can take it. We can take it. A lot of people have been working on it. I know that. And with all the spiritual teachers, many spiritual teachers in the world who have been helping, they've been working out, they're helping others work on it, etc., etc. But we need a big boost now, which is, again, the global challenge, 213, 216, is to take on that challenge. Right mind, right use of time, big boost, big boost. So we take that step, a perception of presence. We take that step. If we don't, okay, I talked about they're trying to burn us all out. Okay, the younger generations, those who are working for this plan to build utopia here in this world, their plan is to burn us out, burn us out, burn us out. And here we go. What do I see today? I see this right here. Warren, it's not pretty.
This is what the world is going to look like very soon, so take a good look. Not much you can do with this, can you? Not much you can do with this. Oh my gosh. This is bad news, folks. Bad, bad news. This is what the world is going to look like. Very soon. Look. Just look at what fire does. Absolutely. Just meltdown, complete meltdown of metal. Wow. Not nice. Fiberglass. Not melted. You just look at what fire does. Absolutely. Toast it.
There you go. There you go. Okay. That's what you're going to end up like if you do not really push to perception of presence. You're going to get burned out. They're trying to burn us out. And of course, when you're young, you can have some resistance to burnout. But when you've been under this pressure, I've been under burnout pressure my entire life. I don't have any resistance to it. Don't have any resistance anymore. I'm already burned out. So I need perception of presence, which is the remedy. It's the inoculation for burnout. It really is. And we have every right to take that inoculation. Everybody does on this planet. I extend the offer to everybody. Absolutely. Without exception. Especially the older people who are already burned out already. My gosh. Need to get wise. Need to get that inoculation. The perception of presence is necessary. Necessary. It's more necessary than working out, you know, more necessary than retirement, more necessary than anything. Anything. Because then you will be truly, we can only go on the role models that we have and what they tell us. And like, for instance, Ananda Mai Ma, she was never tired. She could go week after week around the clock, never sleeping, week after week, extreme activity that an hour, 2 hours of this activity would have tired other people out. And she didn't show any signs of tiring out at all. Now, eventually, she said that the body did need a little rest from this stuff. But she said it's not like fatigue, it's just simply the body to function. There was some need to take a few days off. But she recharged very quickly. And then was able to go again in an extraordinary the endurance. This is unparalleled endurance. She had unparalleled endurance. It's just stuff that just blew people's minds. They could not understand how it's even possible. It's impossible, the endurance she had. And again, she said she had no need to sleep at all. She never even slept. the body, she'd say, she put the body down and closed the body's eyes, etc. But she used to, was wide awake always without any fatigue or problem. But she said most people need to sleep, absolutely. But the perception of presence brings this fresh vitality with it. Different kind of vitality than what we're used to. And actually, I've seen how all thoughts of working towards completion go. The mind is so fresh and still, and there's some way that fatigue goes, and all this stuff goes, and you're very vibrant, very vibrant. You can't be burned out. You cannot be burned out. Cannot. So that is, it is the remedy. It is the remedy, okay? Perception of presence is the big boost. It is the remedy. We need to take up this global challenge globally, because we're all in the crosshairs of this burnout. And we need to succeed. We need to succeed. I intend to succeed at this. And I intend for you to succeed also. And you can. You absolutely can. It's not impossible to succeed at this. It's not futile. It's not a futile endeavor. And there are those who I can see have been trying to succeed. I'm not sure if they totally grasp the context of it. But I'm aware that there are those and go to spiritual teachers who are trying to succeed based on their definition of what success, of succeeding, of dropping all success altogether. They've been trying. So it's going to be interesting to see how this unfolds coming up. Maybe there's a whole bunch of spiritual role models that will come out of the woodwork at this time. I'm hoping so. I'm not seeing it happening right now, but I'm sure hoping so. Or they could use a big boost, actually, and maybe then they'll get it. Because there's been, for decades and decades, a lot of people going to spiritual teachers and trying. So we don't know who's hiding in the weeds, what's in the woodwork, so to speak. Who's going to come out of the spiritual closet and say, hey, here I am, folks. I have the perception of presence. And I'm here to reassure you that you can do it too. It's right there. Just recognize this central key dynamic. Continuity is the only issue. The way to deal with it is by seeing no change, no process, no effort to complete anything. No effort to complete anything. You're not seeing any effort. You're not seeing anything going towards any completion. You're not seeing anything moving towards any state of completion. Nothing. You're seeing only right now. Stillness. Everything is perfectly immaculately still. That vision of immaculate stillness is within our grasp. It is something we can do. Something we will do. It's the global challenge. 213, 216. If you don't do it, you're going to be burned out. Especially the older people. Younger people, the burnout will hit them too. I talk to doctors who say they can't believe. They say the burnout, the young people, they're getting illnesses from burnout that only the older people used to get. They're saying they're seeing 20-something people coming in with illnesses from chronic stress that usually you see 60-year-old people getting. Severe rheumatoid arthritis and all these things, you know. Burnout in their 20s now. That's how severe it is. And you've got these dynamos who are trying to just burn everybody out, thinking that's a great way to solve the problems here and institute their brave new world, new world order kind of stuff in the way they want to do it. And again, we don't have to be subject ourselves to that. Again, don't fight against it. Don't confront it. Accept the presence, the perception of presence. That's the answer. That is where you must put your efforts. The more you fight against it, the more they think they have to control you, the more draconian they will become. And they have the power and the means and all to do all this stuff. It's like the Jews fighting the Roman Empire, the Maccabee Revolt, trying to overthrow Rome. Come on. That's when Jesus came in and said, hey, that's not smart. Don't do it that way. I show you a better way. Jesus came knowing that they were going to do this. They said, hey, there's a better way. Here's a New Testament. This is how you do it. Perception of presence is how you do it. And some listened, some didn't. And those who didn't listen, well, of course, they revolted against Rome and tried to overthrow Rome. And look what happened. Rome got mad at them. Very, very mad. Very, very angry at them. And came in and tore every building down, absolutely tore it to pieces. So we're in modern Rome right now. We're in modern times. Modern times reflect 2,000 years ago to a great extent, which is why Jesus come back and given us a course in miracles and explained to us, this is how you do it. This is how you do it. Perception of presence is how you do it. And we need to get it this time. We need to get it. Otherwise, we'll suffer the fate of those who don't get it. So I hope this has helped you get it to some extent, and I will continue to try to reassure you to get it. All right. Very great. That's it.